Senator Joe Lieberman, thank you for talking with us.
Judy, good to be with you. Thank you.
At the very moment you are set to retire from the Senate, your state of Connecticut is the site of one of the worst mass shootings in American history, the worst in terms of the age of the victims. One of the residents of Newtown said on the NewsHour last night, she said, the politicians have failed to protect our children. Is she right?
Well, I think in some very real ways, the politicians, our society, has failed to carry out what you'd think would be the most fundamental, natural responsibility of any society, which is to protect its children. And I think that's why the tragedy, the murders last Friday in Newtown, Connecticut, have so shaken not only our state, but the entire country. People are heartbroken. People are angry that we let it happen. And I think people are feeling guilty. And I hope we'll act on all those emotions before they dissipate and do whatever we can to prevent it from happening again. We're not going to stop violence, but there are things we can do to reduce the number of incidents that we have like this.
There is this widespread view, Senator, that American politicians have been frightened, intimidated by the powerful gun lobby.
Yeah.
When you think about how long it's been since any legislation was passed, action was taken, is that an accurate view of how things work now in Washington?
Well, I'd say that there is reason for people to be angry, skeptical, and cynical about willingness or capacity of Congress to act to stop mass violence in our country, particularly the part of it that is caused by guns. Because, look, even after there was the attempted assassination on President Reagan and his press secretary, Jim Brady, was hit, it was 7 years until the Brady Act was adopted. And that and the assault ban that was adopted around that same time, 1993-94, are the last real gun control measures that have been adopted after every previous act of mass violence, shooting, Columbine, right through the mall in Oregon last week. Really, nothing has been done. And I don't blame people for being angry. And I hope and I believe I see the beginning of a different reaction here in Washington.
Well, you've called for a national commission. The president today is organizing, announcing a task force. Is that what you have in mind? And in fact, as you say, the residents of Newtown on our program last night were saying, every time there's been a shooting in the past, they said something was going to be done.
Right.
It wasn't done.
Yeah.
And they said, we want something done now.
Yeah, I don't blame them. Look, my feeling is that the president, by executive action, Congress, as soon as it can, should do whatever it can do quickly to make it less likely that something like the shootings in Newtown will happen again. Obviously, I'm talking now about additional gun control laws. I would vote today to restore the assault weapons ban. These are military weapons. There's no need for them in hunting or target practice. I would close the so-called gun show loophole. If you buy a gun at a licensed federal firearms dealer, you got to go through a background check. If you buy it at a gun show, you don't. That's ridiculous. The reason I'm proposing a commission is that there are other elements of this that are going to take more time and ought to be part of a national conversation. For instance, what do you do with a troubled person before they become a killer? What about the impact of violence in the entertainment culture? What should our schools and mental health system be doing to try to find potential murderers before they become murderers? Those are serious questions that you can't solve overnight. But in terms of additional gun control legislation, that ought to be done as soon as possible.
But you're for the assault weapons ban, even though the evidence shows that the last time there was one, there was no appreciable drop in the nation's crime rate.
Well, I think there was certainly an appreciable drop in the number of people killed with assault weapons during the time that ban was there. Look, there's no one thing we're going to do that's going to end violence or end gun violence. Our goal has got to be to reduce the number of people killed with guns. And one of the things that will definitely help us do that is to make it harder for people who shouldn't have guns to get them, and to make it impossible for people to get essentially military weapons to use for non-military purposes.
Let me ask you about another dilemma, problem facing the Capitol right now, and that's the fiscal cliff.
Yes.
Do you believe it is going to be resolved before January 1st? And do you believe that next year there'll be a longer-term solution found to deal with spending and taxes?
Right. Well, there's not going to be a longer-term solution before the end of the fiscal year when the fiscal cliff hits us in the face. But I hope that we're going to do more than just push the cliff off, which is the weakest, lamest thing we can do. In other words, say, oh, no, we haven't worked it out, so now we're going to adopt legislation to say that we don't go off the cliff until June 30th or September 30th. We can do more than that. I believe that President Obama and Speaker Boehner are actually making progress. And I think that what's possible before the end of the year is that we have a substantial down payment on debt reduction. And I'm saying something over $1 trillion with a combination of spending reductions, including some reforms to entitlements, and tax increases, particularly on wealthier Americans. That would be a significant accomplishment. But frankly, Judy, there are groups in both parties that are pulling at the president and the speaker to keep them from making an agreement. And I hope they'll both have the leadership and the courage to make sure that doesn't happen.
Well, speaking of that pulling in both directions, a lot of people today look at this Capitol, this Congress, and they say it's dysfunctional. Do you believe, as somebody who's served for 24 years, that this is a place, that dysfunction is just a permanent feature of Congress, or do you think something can be done about it?
No, I think something can be done. I also do want to say, though I have to say first, that and of my 24 years here, the last two have been the least productive because they've been the most uncompromising and most partisan. But along the way, in the 22 previous years, we got a lot of things done. It wasn't a straight line. Sometimes you'd have times of worse partisanship, sometimes less. But I've been privileged to be part of major steps forward in environmental protection, national security, civil rights, human rights, education reform. And every one of those things was bipartisan, particularly in the Senate. You can't get anything done on a partisan basis in the Senate because you need 60 votes here to break a filibuster. So it can and must get better. But right now, it's at the bottom. It's at the pits, really. And I don't blame people in the country for being angry.
When you left the Democratic Party 6 years ago, becoming independent, you became closer to a number of Republicans. John McCain was very close to naming you as his vice presidential running mate. You spoke at the Republican convention in 2008. Which party do you feel closer to today?
Well, I actually am most comfortable as an independent, and I think I'm probably reflective of maybe not a majority of people in the country, but a plurality anyway, because that is, there's more independents, my independent-minded people than Republicans or Democrats, and that's because I don't find the range of positions that I believe in either party. Generally speaking, Democratic Party feels to me to be more comfortable on a lot of domestic issues. Generally speaking, the Republican Party seems to be me to be more comfortable on foreign policy and security issues, and it's kind of a mix on what I'd call pro-growth economics. So right now I'm where I should be, really, as an independent.
Well, you, when you were recently asked by the New York Times to name, I guess, the three senators you felt the closest to in the Senate, it was three Republicans that you named. So, I mean, I want to ask you, you know, there's a lot of conversation right now about what does the Republican Party need to do after the terrible losses it suffered in the polls this year. Do you have a thought about that?
Well, they need to come back to where the public is. I mean, frankly, they lost touch with that large plurality in the middle of independence. To me, one of the most fascinating, instructive numbers on the exit polls was that among self-described moderates, President Obama got 15% more votes than Governor Romney. So a lot of people in this country think President Obama is center-left or even far-left, but for self-described moderates, it became a choice between Obama the Democrat and Romney the Republican, and 15% more of them thought that Romney the Republican was too far over to, I'd say, the right side. So I think the Republicans have to come back to where the people are, and they can do it with, they're particularly out of touch on what I'd call social issues. You might say libertarian issues, personal liberties, and also on matters like immigration.
A word of advice for President Obama for the next 4 years?
Well, I think President Obama should feel very good about the election and really should work hard, as I think he's doing now with John Boehner, work persistently and not let himself get discouraged if the Republicans seem to be pushing him off for partisan reasons, because there's so much that he can do, but he will not do it unless he engages some critical mass of Republicans. And of course, they've got to be willing to set aside rigid partisanship and ideological purity and come to the middle and compromise with the president to deal with big problems like the debt, like the economy, like cybersecurity, like climate change, for instance. So I hope that'll happen. President, most of all, has the mandate to be a leader. And I'll tell you that I think he's off to a good start of leadership since the election. And I felt it the other night in Newtown. He brought not only comfort to Newtown, Connecticut, he brought resolve that we're not going to tolerate these kinds of tragedies anymore.
Let me ask you finally about two appointments he may be making shortly. You've taken a deep interest in international affairs.
Right.
There's a strong view the president's prepared to name Senator John Kerry to be Secretary of State. You serve with John Kerry in the Senate. You know him very well. What would you think if he were named?
Well, I'd be really happy if John Kerry were named Secretary of State. Some of this is personal bias. John Kerry and I met each other at college. We've been friends for a long time. He recruited me to run for the United States Senate in 1987. We haven't agreed on everything, but this man is really ready to be Secretary of State. He's conversant with all the areas of our foreign policy. He's been involved in all of them. He's already brought some mediating skills, diplomatic skills to some real conflict areas like Afghanistan and Pakistan. So I think John Kerry would be a great Secretary of State.
And another appointment we understand the president may be about to make is someone you served in the Senate with for 12 years, Republican Senator Chuck Hagel of Nebraska. We read now that there are organized outside groups lobbying against this. They feel he has not been sufficiently loyal to the state of Israel. You are probably Israel's greatest supporter.
Well, there's a lot of great supporters of Israel here.
Well,
yeah,
you
but,
certainly have been
yeah. no, of course.
An outspoken advocate. Is that an appointment you'd be comfortable
yeah.
with?
Yeah. So I served with Chuck Hagel. I like him. I respect him. I must say that I'm not as enthusiastic, or let's put it this way, not as clear of mind about Chuck Hagel as defense secretary as I am about how good it would be to have John Kerry as Secretary of State. And we disagreed on some things when he was here, but there are real questions to be raised, not just about Israel. Chuck Hagel has generally been opposed to the application of economic sanctions, not just against Iran, but against countries like North Korea and even the terrorist group Hamas. And I'm puzzled by that, because usually economic sanctions are a way to avoid a choice of either doing nothing or going to war. So I think on his record of what he said, there are questions. I wouldn't say that I'm opposed to Chuck Hagel as defense secretary. Of course, I'm not going to be here if he's nominated to consider his nomination. But if I were here and on the Armed Services Committee still, I'd have a bunch of questions to ask and want to have answered before I would say I could support his nomination.
Senator Joe Lieberman,
thanks,
leaving
Judy.
The Senate after 24 years.
Yes,
thank
ma'am.
You.